evening, everybody, and welcome to our Sunday night live stream service where we are going to worship and look into His Word. So I just want to encourage you. Let's give Him honor, glory, and praise, for He is the one who is good. Lord, we thank You for being so good to us. Thank You for being so good and faithful. For we have no one else to turn to but You, because You are the faithful. So we will trust in You, Lord. We pray tonight, Lord, speak to our hearts. Fill us with Your wisdom. May Your grace and mercy just be poured down on us as we seek Your face. We want to touch Your heart with our praises. Lord, we love You. And we will sing it, say it over and over again, because You are worthy. In Your precious name we pray.
So good, always good. every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
Time.
Worthy of all our praise, for you are great. You are Lord. You are God. And we will trust no other, Lord. And we will cry out to no other. Lord, for you have proven yourself time and time again. And tonight we pray, Lord, take us in your arms. Hold us in your arms, Lord Jesus. For you are the one who gives life, and you give it in abundance, Lord. So we will trust in your word, and we will look to you tonight, Lord. Our hearts cry out to you, and our souls cry out to you tonight, Lord. So all we have left is to lift up our hands and tell you how much we love you. Lord, you are worthy of all our praise, and we thank you for your love. Your holy and precious name we pray. Lord Jesus, amen. Amen.
Hi, everybody. Just a few announcements before we get into our Bible study. Pastor Jimmy recorded the sermon we're about to hear on Thursday, and a lot has changed since then. He asked us to pray about opening next Sunday, but President Trump's Friday announcement that churches are now essential businesses has caused the board to decide that we are indeed opening next Sunday. Now, we're excited about getting back together, but we need to remind you that we're not coming back to normal services. We're expected to observe CDC guidelines for preventing the spread of COVID-19, and so there are going to be some changes. One of the biggest changes will be the implementation of social distancing in the sanctuary. Because of the way we've had to configure the chairs, we're down to less than 30% of our normal sanctuary capacity. For that reason, we'll be setting up a reservation system for attendance. We'll also be continuing the live stream services for those that cannot or should not join us. Pastor Jimmy will be releasing some instructions early this week that will give more details about next Sunday. We'll be able to find them on the website. Last week, I mentioned the upcoming election. I know that many of you are not happy with how this election is taking place, using mail-in ballots only. Frankly, I'm not happy with it either. Nevertheless, choosing not to vote merely turns over the government to those whose values are the complete opposite of ours. So I encourage you to fill out your ballot, get it in the mail before the June 9th deadline, or if you prefer, you can drop off your ballot in person. Just be sure to follow the instructions on your ballot. Now, many of you have asked for help in determining who to vote for, or which candidates line up with our Christian values. Frankly, I can't tell you who to vote for, but I do encourage you to do some research. There's a brand new Christian-based voter guide out available, and it's called iVoterGuide.com. Again, that's iVoterGuide.com. Go to that website, simply add in your zip code, and it will show you all of your candidates and a lot of information about them. Lone Mountain Homeschool Association's high school graduation and promotion ceremony is coming up this Friday, May 29th. The performance and promotion portion begins at 6 p.m. The graduation ceremony begins at 7 p.m. Now, this event will still be live streamed only, but we do encourage you to drive by the church at 8 p.m. to congratulate the graduates. Now, with all of that said, let's pray over our tithes and offerings and over our service. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to gather together electronically one last time, Lord, as we prepare to reopen, as we prepare to come back together. We pray, Lord, that you would bless this service. You would bless the message that Pastor Jimmy has recorded and, Lord, have it penetrate into our hearts. We pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would come over us. And as we prepare to reopen, as we prepare to have a homecoming, if you will, Lord, we pray that you would help us to do so wisely and safely. We pray for your hand of protection over Calvary Chapel Lone Mountain, all of our family and friends as we gather together. And we do pray over these tithes and offerings, Lord, that they would be a blessing to you and that that they would be multiplied and sent throughout your kingdom until every ear has heard the gospel message of your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray all these things in his precious name. Amen.
Well, good evening. It is so good to be with you tonight. And tragically, it's one more service. We're not together, but you know, at least we're hashtag together, not together. But we are going to be together soon. I know I keep saying that, and you're probably tired of hearing it, but I really mean it now. An injunction was actually filed on our behalf in the courts on Thursday. So by the way, this would be a good week for special prayer and fasting dedicated to this case. We are hoping that we'll be able to meet next Sunday, and we're expecting the courts to give us a TPO, temporary protective order, that will allow us to meet while the courts figure this thing out. But we are in the process of fighting to make this thing happen, and Lord willing, we won't have to social disobedience or whatever they call that stuff, civil disobedience to make it happen, but practice civil disobedience. But hopefully next week we'll be able to meet legitimately. Now, that being said, because I can't announce right now that we are meeting next Sunday or not meeting next Sunday, the only way you're going to know is if you are keeping up with us in the various places where we communicate these things. So let me just kind of get you up to speed on how you can find out whether we're meeting next Sunday or not. One, you can follow us on Instagram. CC Lone Mountain is our name on Instagram. You can follow us there, and it'll be posted on Instagram. If you follow me on my personal Instagram, I'm sure I'll be talking about it there as well. And I tell you what my name is, but I don't actually remember what it is, some kind of Rad Daddio or something weird like that. You can follow me there. You can follow us on Facebook. If you're following Calvary Chapel Lone Mountain on Facebook, you'll get an update there as well. Probably the main place you'll want to check is on the webpage, cclonemountain.org. And we'll certainly have updates there as to what's going to happen next Sunday, and we'll have more information there that you'll need, and I'll talk about in a minute. But while you're there at cclonemountain.org, one of the things you can also do is get on our email list. Listen, we don't sell email addresses. We don't spam people. All we do with your email address is send you like a monthly newsletter to keep you up to date on things that are going on around the church and regular updates as things happen, major events happen, so that you can stay in the know, stay in the loop. And so if you want to know what's going on at church, then get on our email list and we'll send you those emails and you'll know what's happening for sure. But when we come together, and by the way, you may actually find out whether we're meeting or not through the news, because apparently we've been on the news. I haven't seen any of the news stories, but I'm actually getting emails from people that have seen the news stories, and they're talking about our case. We are actually the only church involved in this case that we got asked to be involved in, and it's kind of interesting how it all came about, but it's kind of a big deal, because if we win, then all the churches win. And so there are other pastors who've been contacting me and letting me know that they're praying for us and they're supporting us in this. And so they're all watching, because this battle is not just for us, but for the church statewide. And so pray that we would be victorious in our legal challenges regarding the constitutionality of the governor's actions. So when we do come to back together, one of the things you need to know ahead of time is that it is going to be in a modified fashion. And so what that means is there won't be just kind of like show up at church and anybody who comes can come. We'll be limited in the number of people that can come. And right now I think we've got about 140-something, 150 chairs set up in the sanctuary. And so it's really quite a few less than we normally have. And so we're going to be doing like a reservation system where you can let us know that you're coming. You don't have to buy tickets or anything, but you do have to at least register so we know you're coming, and that way we can save you a seat. And if you do show up and you don't have a seat, then it'll be, we know, any empty seats that aren't reserved or any seats that aren't claimed when the service starts, or you'll be in the overflow in the youth room watching a live stream, or we're actually going to start broadcasting the services in the parking lot on FM through an FM signal. And so you'll actually be able to sit in your car if you want and hear the message, or you can also look at it on your phone in your car if you want, because it's on YouTube and Facebook Live, and so you'll be able to see it there. You'll get specific instructions as soon as we find out we are opening on what the process is going to be and what we're going to ask of you when we do this, and all the details. And so those are coming this week. They'll be on social media, on Instagram, Facebook, and they'll be on the webpage. And the registration thing for coming to service will be on the webpage at cclonemountain.org. So keep your eyes peeled, keep your ears tuned, and pay attention to what's going on this week. And more than anything, be in prayer, and I'm asking you to pray and fast this week about these things. So, Genesis chapter 49. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, as we look to your word, we pray that you would speak to our hearts, that you would speak to us about the things that are near and dear to your heart, and Lord, that you would minister in power through your word. Father, for those who know you, that you would cause us to fall more in love with you. For those who don't know you, Lord, I pray that you would draw them to yourself, grant them eternal life as they recognize the reality of who you are. We love you. We praise things in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're coming to the end of our study in the book of Genesis. In fact, I planned on finishing the book of Genesis tonight, but as I started to prepare this study, the part of chapter 49 got so long that I decided that it was too important to try to rush through it, and I cut as much stuff as I could, and it was still too long to add chapter 50, and so I decided to break it up into two parts, and tonight we'll just look at chapter 49, because chapter 49 is really too important to just fly through. It's Jacob's kind of deathbed prophecies over his son, and in it, he gives us the future of Israel. So verse 1, Jacob called his sons and said, "Gather together that I may tell you what shall befall you in the last days. So, you know, this is when a Hebrew dad got to the end of his life, he would pass on a blessing, a birthright to the oldest son, a blessing to all the other children, some special blessing for them. This is kind of that, but it's not really a blessing as much as it's Jacob's prophecy regarding his son. And his prophecy is really based on their, mostly on their individual characters. In fact, a lot of prophecy is more forthtelling as much as foretelling, where you just look at someone's life and say, listen, you continue living like that, the Bible says this is what's going to happen. Well, Jacob goes a little further and says specifically, hey, you're like this, and this is what's going to become of you as a result of it. Gather together and hear, you sons of Jacob, and listen to Israel, your father. So the boys are standing around the bed now as Jacob is about to die, and they're probably standing in order of their birth around the table to receive the various blessings. So he starts with the firstborn, who would be the nearest to him, and he would lay his hand on his head. And he said, Reuben, you are my firstborn, my might, and the beginning of my strength, the excellency of dignity and the excellency of power. What a nice beginning. I mean, what a beautiful way to start his words to Reuben. And Reuben should have received a double portion. Sadly, he didn't stop there. Verse 2, unstable as water, you shall not excel. I love that phrase, unstable as water. You know, if you try to pour water into a container, you remove the container, the water falls and takes the shape of whatever it's in. And that's what it means when you're unstable as water. You just kind of, you're going to mold yourself to anything. Now, unstable as water, you shall not excel, because you went up to your father's bed, then you defiled it. He went up to my couch. Now, not one member of the family of Reuben ever excelled in Scripture. So, boy, this really came to pass to the letter. Later, Reuben wanted his portion of his inheritance outside of the promised land, and he never amounted to anything outside of the land, the tribe of Reuben. See, Reuben had a major character flaw. He could not maintain himself in purity. But instead, he went into Jacob's handmaiden Bilhah, and Jacob never said much about it at the time, but don't think he ever forgot. On his deathbed, he let Reuben know that there was a cost for that sexual immorality, that impurity on his part. Verse 5, Simeon and Levi are brothers. They were apparently very close brothers. Instruments of cruelty are in their dwelling place. Let not my soul enter their counsel. Let not my honor be united to their assembly. For in their anger they slew a man, and in their self-will they hamstrung an ox. Cursed be their anger, for it is fierce, and their wrath, for it is cruel. I will divide them in Jacob and scatter them in Israel. So Simeon and Levi seem to have a closer intimacy than any of the other brothers. They seem to be inseparable as brothers. The problem is that that bond between them was not rooted in righteousness. It was not a friendship where iron sharpened iron. It was a common meanness between them. They were both so evil that they turned to each other because they had somebody that could relate to them. They were violent, cruel, and self-willed, said Jacob, and that's what brought them together, but it would scatter them in the end. Simeon was scattered throughout the land, mostly absorbed by the tribe of Judah. Levi didn't receive an inheritance, but was also scattered throughout the land among 48 in cities that they were scattered into. So this came to pass, again, to the letter, they weren't together. Judah, you are he whom your brothers shall praise. Judah means praise, and his brothers would indeed praise him. Your hand shall be on the neck of your enemies. Your father's children shall bow down before you. You see, from Judah would come the king, the one to whom, Philippians chapter 2, verse 10, every knee would bow of those in heaven and of those on the earth, of those under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. So this really came to pass that the brothers bowed down to Judah. Now, Judah was the brother who demonstrated a real change of character. Remember when Joseph's brother threw Joseph into the pit and planned to kill him, that Judah was the one that suggested selling him to the passing caravan of slave traders. But he did it not because he was greedy, but because he was trying to keep his brother alive. He didn't know Reuben planned on coming back later to rescue him. And so to save his life, he had him sold instead of letting the brothers just kill him. But later, when Jacob wouldn't let Benjamin go down to Egypt, it was Judah who offered to be a surety for him. It was Judah who said, listen, I will lay down my life for him. If something happens to him, you know, kill me. He was the most responsible of the brothers. And when Joseph sought to keep Benjamin behind as a slave, it was Judah who offered himself in the place of his brother. He was the one that demonstrated a real depth of character. And so Jacob carries that on in his prophecy. Verse 9, Judah is a lion's whelp. From the prey, my son, you have gone up. He bows down. He lies down as a lion. And as a lion, who shall rouse him? You see, he became the one from whom would come the lion of the tribe of Judah. The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet until Shiloh comes, and to him shall be the obedience of the people. So Shiloh is a reference to the Messiah, and it has it at its root, Shalom, peace. The Messiah is the one who would bring peace, so he was called Shiloh, the Prince of Peace, right? And he would bring peace between man and God. And the scepter, when it says the scepter would not depart from Judah, the Israelis understood that through their rabbis, through their teachings over the centuries, to mean that the Messiah, that there would always be in Israel the permission to govern themselves. They would always have a king and until the Messiah came. And it was somewhere around 4 AD that the death penalty ability was taken away from Israel by the Romans, and scholars ran through the streets crying that the scriptures have failed, the scepter has been taken from Judah, and Shiloh hasn't come. But little did they know, he was there among them at that time. The Messiah had come. He had to have come before 70 AD, or this scripture has failed. It's the only scripture, the only prophecy in the scriptures that has ever failed if he hadn't come. But he did come. Now, considering this prophecy, we find the words of the Lord intriguing as he rode over the Mount of Olives on that day that he declared himself to be the Messiah, the Lord. He said in Luke 19:41, as he drew near, he saw the city and wept over it, saying, if you had known, even you, especially in this your day, the things that make for your peace, your shalom, but now they are hidden from your eyes. You see, he told them, hey, Shiloh has come, your peace has come, but you missed it. The scepter would now pass, but Shiloh had come. So verse 11, binding his donkey to the vine and his donkey's colt to the choice vine. That's predicting the way Jesus would ride in. He washed his garments in wine and his clothes in the blood of grapes. His eyes are darker than wine and his teeth whiter than milk. Zebulun shall be by the haven of the sea. He shall become a haven for ships, and his border shall adjoin Sidon. So Zebulun was given the northwestern part of Israel, which today is Akko, the major port city in Israel, and His portion went up into what is modern Lebanon, but he never took his full portion. Issachar, verse 14, is a strong donkey lying down between two burdens. He saw that rest was good and that the land was pleasant. He bowed his shoulder to bear a burden and became a band of slaves. In other words, Issachar was strong and lazy. Always a bad combination. Those two characteristics together always lead to slavery. You might be strong, but if you're lazy, you can be sure you will end up in bondage. You will end up bearing somebody else's burdens. Idle hands truly are the devil's workshop. Verse 16, Dan shall judge his people as one of the tribes of Israel. Dan actually means judge. Dan shall be a serpent by the way, a viper by the path that bites the horse's heels so that its rider shall fall backwards. See, Dan inherited the area of the Hula Valley in the far north of Israel. In fact, the ruins of Dan are still there, about 4 to 5 miles from the base of Mount Hermon. And Dan actually did turn out to be an incredibly tough tribe. Dan protected Israel from many of the invasions that came from the north. In fact, every major invasion against Israel came from the north, and Dan was always the first hit, and Dan always was ready for the fight. Suddenly, Jacob cries out, verse 18, I have waited for your salvation, O Lord. Now, this is a fascinating cry of Jacob. It has nothing to do with his prophecy regarding Dan. Just out of the blue, he says this. And this is the first mention of the word salvation in the Bible. But there's something more amazing about it, way more amazing than just that. The words translated salvation, O Lord, I have waited for your salvation, O Lord, are one word in the Hebrew, Yeshua or Yehoshua. He literally cried out, I have waited for you, Jesus. That's what Jacob said. Isn't that amazing? I mean, here he is crying out for the salvation of the Lord, crying out for Yehoshua, for God's salvation, for Jesus. Verse 19, Gad, a troop shall tramp upon him, but he shall triumph at last. In fact, Gad literally means a troop. And Gad was given an inheritance with Reuben outside of the promised land on the other side of the Jordan. And they were overcome early. But the prophecy is that in the end, they would overcome. Verse 20, bread from Asher shall be rich, and he shall yield royal dainties. So Asher would become the baker tribe. They would produce great breads and pastries. And this prophecy is still being fulfilled today. I know it is, because every time we go to Israel, one of the things that always impresses me are the incredible pastries that you're served there everywhere you go. Some of the best pastries you'll have in the world. I'm sure they're baked by Asher. Naphtali, verse 21, I'm just kidding around, is a deer let loose. He uses beautiful words. So Naphtali would be basically a beautiful rider, and I don't know how that was fulfilled. Joseph is a fruitful bough by a well. His branches run over the wall. The archers have bitterly grieved him, shot at him, and hated him. But his bow remained in strength, and the arms, get this, the arms of his hands were made strong by the hands of the mighty God of Jacob. From there is the shepherd, the stone of Israel. What an amazing, amazing statement. I'll come back to it in a second. By the God of your father who will help you, and by the Almighty who will bless you with blessings of heaven above, blessings of the deep that lies beneath, blessings of the breasts and of the womb, the blessings of your father have excelled the blessings of my ancestors up to the utmost bound of the everlasting hills. They shall be on the head of Joseph and on the crown of the head of him who was separate from his brothers. Joseph was separated from his brothers. But Joseph is saying, Jacob is saying, even though he was separated from his brothers, he will be blessed beyond his brothers. Ephraim and Manasseh became great and fruitful tribes. Those were the sons of Joseph. And not only was he blessed, he became a blessing to others. Notice what he said. His branches ran over the wall. Why was he a blessing? Because of his godliness. Because he was such a godly man, he blessed all his brothers. He wasn't about himself. He was about others. But with godliness comes persecution. And so he was sorely persecuted. As Paul wrote in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12, yes, and all who desire to live godly shall suffer, to live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. If you want to be guaranteed persecution, just choose to live without compromise following Jesus. You will suffer. So it was with Joseph. The archers bitterly grieved him, shot at him, and hated him. All the arrows of bitterness and hatred came his way, even from his brothers. But he never retaliated. Notice Joseph said, Jacob said, his bow remained in strength. You know what that means? That means he forgave them, he loved them, and he entrusted vengeance with God. That's what that means. He trusted that God would take care of him. He turned the other cheek and blessed those who persecuted. And what was the secret of his strength? What gave him the strength to hold his bow back, to not shoot the arrow when he thought he should have? His hands were strengthened by God's hands. His hands were made strong by the hands of the mighty God of Jacob. And I'm going to tell you, that is a truly remarkable and beautiful example for us. When somebody hurts you, when somebody does something evil to you, to be able to say, hey, I don't need to get revenge. I don't need to retaliate. My arm is strong, not because of my strength, but because the hand of God is on my hand, holding my arm back. I remember when I was a little boy, and I was 14 years old, and I was rebuilding my first engine, and a little Toyota Corona. And I had that thing almost all apart, and I was underneath the car, and there was this one bolt that was just on there so tight, and I tried every angle, and I tried kicking it with my feet, and I tried pulling and pushing and everything I could do to get that bolt to turn, and it would not move. I had the biggest wrench I could find, and that bolt would not budge no matter what, and I thought, this is never going to happen. I remember my dad coming out, and he saw me under there, and he started talking and wanted to have a man-to-man conversation with his son. He starts chit-chatting as I'm laying there trying to get that bolt. And finally I said, Dad, can you just help me? And he went, oh, yeah, sure, son. And he got under there, and I was sitting here pushing with all my strength on that wrench. And he's put his hand on the end of the wrench and just went click, and the bolt let loose like it was nothing. And I thought, man, Dad's strong. But you know, Dad wasn't strong compared to what, to God's strength. God's strength is strong. And if he holds your hand, you have all the strength you need to walk in holiness and righteousness, to walk in forgiveness and love and grace. And God will keep your bow strong. We don't have to give in to the temptation to explode at others. We don't have to retaliate when we're hurt, and somehow justify our retaliation by saying, well, that's just the way I am. I'm Puerto Rican or I'm Italian. Listen, you can't restrain yourself and excuse yourself saying, I'm an Italian, and so I can't help it. That's just the way I am. No, the reason you can't help it is because you're a sinner and you're walking in the flesh. But God wants to change that. Die to yourself, yield to him, and let him strengthen your hands. Not to fight better, but to not fight at all. To restrain yourself and to trust God to be your defender. Do you have a hot head? Are you tired of it yet? You should be. If you're not tired of it yet, may the Lord make you tired of it. But if you have a hot head, listen, you can be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And the Lord wants to live in you and through you and transform you. As Paul said in Galatians 2:20, I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. You can live a whole new life in his power, and that life will be a life that will blow the world away, because your power won't be seen in your strength and your action. It'll be seen in your restraint and your forgiveness and your incredible love. God was the secret of Joseph's strength, and he can be the secret of your strength as well. Let him strengthen your hand to hold your bow back. Verse 27, Benjamin is a ravenous wolf. In the morning he shall devour the prey, and at night he shall divide the spoil. Benjamin became one of the toughest tribes in Israel, but he also became one of the most wicked tribes in Israel, and he was almost wiped out as a result of it. The first king of Israel came from Benjamin, Saul, and Paul came from Benjamin. Paul, who was Saul of Tarsus, he was of the tribe of Benjamin. He was tough and able to endure great hardship because he was the son of Benjamin in the spirit. And so he could take that toughness and use it for God's glory. But Benjamin was indeed a tough tribe. Verse 28, all these are the 12 tribes of Israel, and this is what their father spoke to them. And he blessed them. He blessed each one according to his own blessing. Then he charged them and said to them, I am to be gathered to my people. Bury me with my fathers in the cave that is in the field of Ephron the Hittite, in the cave that is in the field of Machpelah, which is before Mamre in the land of Canaan, which Abraham bought with the field of Ephron the Hittite as a possession for a burial place. So they buried Abraham and Sarah, his wife, there, he said, they buried Isaac and Rebekah, his wife, and there I buried Leah. The field and the cave that is there were purchased from the sons of Heth. And when Jacob had finished commanding his sons, he drew his feet up into the bed and breathed his last and was gathered to his people. So this was the dying act of Jacob. He pronounced the future of his sons, and his last words, he demanded to be buried in Canaan next to Leah. Now that's interesting, because he loved Rachel more all his life. He loved Rachel and he loved his sons through Rachel more than all the other sons. Rachel was his dream girl, and you would think he could have demanded to be buried next to her there in Bethlehem. But instead, he chose to be buried next to Leah at the cave of Machpelah. Why? Because it was there that he would be next to his father and his grandfather, to whom the promises were made as well. In other words, that was the place where he was closer to the family of God than he would have been had he been buried with the love of his life, the family of his flesh. And that's so often the case in the church when people start to walk in the spirit. A lot of times our family disowns us. They grow distant from us. But it's so wonderful to have a family in Christ that can be as close and sometimes even closer than our blood family, because that love of the Lord just draws us closer and makes us one flesh in Jesus. So next week we'll finish the book of Genesis, and Lord willing, we might even be able to do it together. But let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the things that you are doing. And we pray, Lord, regarding this court case, that you would bring things to pass for your glory, that you would make things happen that are pleasing to you, Lord, as you want to see them happen. Father, I pray that that you would take your word tonight and you would minister to the hearts of every person that heard it. Father, for your children, that you would make us more like Jesus as a result of it. And Father, for those who don't know you, that they would recognize their need for a Savior as they consider these truths and they recognize your incredible love for them in your Son. Now, maybe you're watching this live stream and you've never put your trust in Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Listen, if you've never believed on Him for the forgiveness of sins, if you've never invited Him into your life to be your Lord and Savior, I want to give you a chance to do that. Why would you do that? Because the wages of sin is death, and all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We're all guilty, so we're all scheduled for hell. But Jesus died on the cross to pay a price that we could never pay. After living a sinless life, He made a way for us to have eternal life with Him, through His blood, through the price He paid. And so, if you want to know your sins are forgiven, if you want to know you're right with God, all you have to do is put your trust in Him as your Lord and Savior. And if you want to do that, I'm going to pray this prayer and just encourage you to repeat it after me. Father, I thank you for loving me enough to send your Son. And Lord Jesus, I thank you for being willing to die on the cross for me. Lord, I believe you paid a price I could never pay. I believe you made a way for my sins to be forgiven. I believe you rose again from the dead. And you made a way for me to have eternal life with you. Lord Jesus, come into my life. Forgive me, for I am a sinner. Cleanse my heart. Make me new. Lord, I put my trust in you this day. And I thank you for what you've done. Now, the Bible says if you just prayed this prayer, you're a child of God. Your sins are forgiven. Your prayers are driven snow in His sight. Paul said, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. Romans chapter 10, verse 9. You can look it up for yourself. But now that you are a child of God, I want to encourage you to let us know so we can pray for you. And we can not only pray for you, but we can send you a little booklet to tell you about this decision you made and help you grow as a Christian. And not only that, but if you need a Bible, we'll send you that. But just click on the link next to the live stream there, and you can let us know you prayed this prayer. Or there's a phone number there you can text, and just text the word saved to that phone number, and a pastor will call you and be glad to pray with you and minister to you. So let us know. But Father, I thank you so much for your love for us. And Lord, I pray that you'd be glorified in us. And I pray for any who have prayed this prayer. Lord, pour out your Spirit upon them in power. Baptize them in your Holy Spirit and use them mightily for your glory. Father, we love you. We look forward to worshiping you together soon. Lord, whether it's here or there before your throne. Lord, come quickly. But if you're not coming this coming week, Lord, bring us together. We love you, Lord. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Lord, bless you and keep you. May He cause His face to shine upon you this week. Don't forget to fast and pray for this court case this week. In Jesus' name. Worship team, go ahead and send us home.
I worship you.
promise keep. Night in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keep. Night in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you, Lord, I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you, I worship. You are here, Lord, turning lives around. I worship you, Lord, I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship.
Never stop.
hearts, Lord, in this nation. Awakening, Holy Spirit, we desire. In our hearts, Lord, in the nation.